Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow. Great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. And bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy.
His heart. grace runs deep as your scars. You pull me from the clay. You set me on a rock. Call me by your name and make my heart whole again. Lift it up.
Good morning and welcome to our worship service at Capel Methodist Church in the beautiful county of Suffolk. Wherever you are watching this service, we're pleased you're joining us. And do make yourself known to us using the contact details on the slide at the start of this service. We're very pleased to welcome Doug Barnett, who's our preacher this morning. Today we're starting a new series as part of the Methodist Bible Month. The book we're looking at is Paul's letter to the Colossians, and today we have the first message entitled, The Supremacy of Christ. As we begin our worship, some words from Psalm 33. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom we have to worship you. Help us now to quieten our hearts before you and to free our minds from distractions. We come to worship you for who you are. For you, Lord, are our Creator and our Saviour. Heavenly Father, help us to be still in your presence, that we may know ourselves to be your people and you to be our God. O Lord, whose mercy reaches to the heavens, whose faithfulness knows no end, make the greatness of your love known to us, that we may worship you with wonder, joy, and thanksgiving. Amen. And a prayer of confession. Our Father, please forgive us for the wrongs we have done, for angry words, from being greedy and wanting the best for ourselves, for making other people unhappy. Forgive us. Forgive us, Lord, for our little respect of you, for the little time we spend with you, for doing things in our own strength, for leaving you out of our plans and then expecting you to bless them. We thank you for your mercy and your grace to change and renew us. Amen. We're going to sing, All Heaven Declares the Glory of the Risen Lord. And then Martin will read today's reading from Colossians. After that, we'll follow some images on screen to help us reflect how awesome is our Creator, that he has made all things visible and invisible. Can you have images of invisible things? Yes, you can, through the wonders of digital imaging, microscopes and telescopes. All heaven declares the glory of the risen Lord.
Forever you will be the Lamb of God. Today's reading comes from Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 to 23. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to God's holy people in Colossae, the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. Grace and peace to you from God our Father. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all God's people. The faith and love that springs from the hope stored up for you in heaven and about which you have already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you. In the same way, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world, just as it has been doing amongst you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with knowledge of his will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all the power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel, this is the gospel that you heard, and which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Thanks be to God.
Beverly will now read our prayers of intercession, and then we'll sing our next song, There is a Higher Throne. After the song, Doug Barnett will speak to us, and then we'll conclude the service. Thank you, Doug, for your ministry to us today. And thank you also to Martin and Beverly Dowsett for reading the scripture and leading our prayers.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that during these continually difficult times, we will see the joy of you in our daily lives. Help us to see you in everything we do, in all our joys and challenges. We marvel at your creation, the signs of new life in the trees and the plants, the wildlife in our hedgerows, and the beauty of sunrise, sunset, and the stars in the sky. As we move towards more relaxation of the lockdown, we pray that we will continue to see the beauty of your creation and take our part in caring for this world. Lord, help us to desire you more, to love and to praise you, for you alone are worthy to be praised. We know that the easing of restrictions brings us hope, but also anxiety. Lord, help us to focus on you and to allow you to lead us with patience, hope, and expectation. Father God, we know in our hearts that we have fallen short of your love. We confess to you the actions and the inactions that we know we should have done differently. Open our eyes and ears, Lord, to hear your voice and to know your will in all we do. We know, Lord, that if we confess our sins, we will be restored back to you. Help us, Lord, to continue to strive to come closer to you in trusting in your love and grace. Thank you for all the love and care so many have given to others during these difficult times, for the acts of kindness that have gone unnoticed to others, a letter, a card, a meal, and a telephone call. We thank you for the development of technology, giving us the opportunity to communicate through new media, to be able to see others and loved ones that we have not been able to visit. We remember so many that have worked so hard to help others over the past year. The NHS, police officers, bus drivers, prison officers, and many more. We pray for those who have spent long periods alone in the last year, for those shielding, those just scared to go out, for prisoners locked in their cells for 23 hours a day and no visits being allowed for nearly a year, for those in care homes longing for a hug from a loved one. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world. So much has happened in the last year that has gone unnoticed because of the pandemic. The earthquakes, famines, civil unrest, political changes and decisions. Help us, Lord, to remember all these in our prayers and consider if we are called to take action individually or as a church. We pray for those who work for peace, even where peace seems impossible. Thank you for all the charities that support the crises around the world. We pray, Lord, that you'll hold them all in the palms of your hands. We pray for our country, for the politicians and local leaders, that they acknowledge the new situation we are in and adapt where necessary the focus of their areas. We pray for the continuing rollout of the vaccine and pray that this will bring hope to all. We pray for our church that as activities can resume, that we look to you for guidance of how we should share our gospel with others in our building and in our community. Help us to look to you in our decision making. Father, we pray for others. Remember those who are unwell at this moment. We pray for your healing touch on them, and peace and patience for those who care for them. We pray for those grieving loved ones, that they will recognise your presence and feel your arms around them. We pray for those suffering from the effects of the lockdown, both physically and mentally, that they will receive the help needed. And Father, we pray for ourselves, that we will see you in all our situations, trust in you when we are worried, and seek to follow you more nearly each day, knowing that you are always by our side. Help us, Lord, to all remember that if we trust in you, we are loved, accepted, forgiven, and restored. We ask these prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Oh, Good morning, everybody. Sorry I can't see you, as it were, at Capel, but you can see me, and I look forward to a time when we can get together person to person. Our theme this morning is the supremacy of Christ, and it's based on Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 to 23, which I believe is a theme that you're following through for the next few weeks. Yakov Smirnov is not a Russian vodka, he's a Russian comedian. And he tells of the time when he made his first visit to America and how he was amazed at the variety of goods that there were in the stores in America. He said he was walking down one of the aisles and he saw milk powder. You just add water and you get milk. Then he saw orange juice powder. You just add water and you get orange juice. And then he saw baby powder. And he thought, my, what a country, what a country. Now, in a sense, that's how I feel when I read Colossians, the epistle of Colossians. I think to myself, what an epistle. Colossians was written in AD 61 to 62 by Paul from a Roman prison. In the English version, there's 4 chapters and 95 verses. Colossae was a city that was cosmopolitan. There were Jewish, Romans, Greeks, and ethnic tribes in the city itself. It was also a challenging place, because when Paul wrote to the church there, he was facing a challenge that the church was facing. He was trying to help them. And the challenge was Gnosticism, which was a mixture of Eastern mysticism, Jewish legalism, and astrology. And what it basically said was that God was so holy, he could have nothing to do with sinful people. And so there was a ladder of angelic beings between earth and heaven. And in order to progress up the ladder to heaven, only the Gnostics knew the secret passwords, and you had to be part of their setup in order to survive. But the problem was for the church and for Paul was that the teaching was that Jesus was not truly God or truly man. He was an angelic being somewhere up that ladder. And so if that designation of the person of Jesus had been allowed to continue, then it would have been like poisoning the bloodstream of the early church. So Paul writes to convey the supremacy of the deity and humanity of Jesus in this epistle. And he speaks about Jesus as God's son and as truly as the Son of Man as well. And also the letter is probably the most Christ-centered letter in the New Testament. And Paul writes to tell them that Jesus is supreme in everything, basically. He says that in all things he might have the preeminence here in chapter 1. And Jesus has the preeminence and supremacy in the church, says Paul. He says that in verse 18, he says that Christ is the head of the body, the church. I don't know about you, I don't know what your favourite film is, but one of my favourite films is Gladiator. And at the start of Gladiator, the Roman army is encamped in the forest in Germania, and they're facing the tribes of Germania. And the tribes come rushing out of the forest, and there's a volley of arrows that flies through the air from the Germanic tribes onto the Roman soldiers. And the front rank of the Roman soldiers raises the shields, and the second rank of the Roman soldiers raises their shields over the heads of the first rank and over their own heads as well. And they are protected. They protect each other and they protect themselves. I love that little point, because it speaks to me of military coordination, of comradeship, of courage, and in a sense of a military community working together for the benefit of each other. And Paul says that Christ is the head of the church. He's supreme in the church. And the church is his body and it's his community. We're part of Christ's community as the church. We protect each other. We support each other. We stand alongside each other. And here in chapter 1, Paul talks about in verse 3, he says that the church is, the fellowship of Colossae is marked by faith in Jesus, by love for each other, love for the saints, and by a hope of heaven. And that's a tremendous trinity for us as Christians to have. But we know that the fellowship of the church is the fellowship of the fallible. because we're human beings. But the fellowship of the fallible is supported by an almighty God who's infallible. Now, some people say, oh, I wish our church didn't have problems. Well, a church without problems is usually a church without people. And I am part of a number of groups in the church that I am a member of. And one of the things about the meetings that I find a challenge is the at the end of the agenda, there's usually an AOB. And the AOB can often be twice as long as the agenda. But what I think about sometimes about AOB as I listen to it is that it's any other belly aches, because a lot of the time there are moans and groans or complaints. Well, we have to live with that, don't we? Because we're human beings, and we don't always see eye to eye, and we don't always get on. But we meet in community. We meet to praise God. We meet to support each other, to pray for each other, and to stand alongside each other in the Christian community. And then we go out into the world as God's salt and light. We go out into the community around us to be the representatives of Jesus in that community as well. Because Christ is the head of the church. He's supreme in the church. And we want to make him known in our community as you do in your community in that respect. But the second thing that Paul says here is that Christ is supreme in creation. He says he's the firstborn in creation in verse 15. Now, that doesn't mean he's the firstborn in sense of a natural birth, but he's the firstborn in the sense of he's preeminent in rank. He is preeminent in authority and status in creation. He outranks everything in creation because he created everything in creation. Science tells me that there are 100 billion galaxies, and that within each galaxy there are 200 billion stars. When I try to multiply 100 billion by 200 billion, I get a headache, a massive headache. But creation is telling me something about the supremacy of Christ and of God. In 1992, the Hubble telescope discovered the Whirlpool Galaxy. Now, the Whirlpool Galaxy is 31 million light years away from us. And right at the heart of the Whirlpool Galaxy is a cross. Now, I'm not an astronomer, but I wonder, as I look at the Whirlpool Galaxy and its center, is God trying to tell me something in creation? And then if you take biology, in biology, there's a substance called laminin in our body. And laminin is a cell adhesion molecule. It's the thing that holds us together deep down inside. It's a protein molecule. But the fascinating thing for me is, and I'm not a biologist, when I look at the shape of laminin in the body or in the textbook, it's shaped like a cross. Now, I'm not a biologist and I'm not an astronomer, but is God trying to tell us something through astronomy and biology? I think he is. I think he's saying he's the creator. He's supreme in creation and in biology. And here's the amazing thing, isn't it? That this God creator, this supreme Christ in creation, he loves you and he loves me, and he died to save us. So the God who created everything has not abandoned everything. He relates to you and to me through the cross and by the resurrection and through the church and its community as well. And the other thing I noticed in this first chapter is that Christ is preeminent and supreme in his character and person. The thing about reading the Bible and the story of Jesus is that in the community in which he lived and operated on earth, when he walked on earth, he was a constant challenge to the leadership and the society and the conventions of the society, and especially the religious conventions, which were there at that day. And I was thinking about if Jesus was walking in his human body here on earth today, what the challenge would be and who would be challenging him. Well, I think Essex and Suffolk Water would be challenging him because he turned water into wine without a license. Probably the NHS would be challenging him because he was healing people without a medical qualification. Probably health and safety and body would be challenging him because he fed 5,000 people in the wilderness and he walked on water without a life jacket. So I've no doubt they would be cross with him as well. And I'm sure that the Equality and Humanities Commission would be after him as well, because he had 12 disciples and not one of them was a woman. Jesus is a constant challenge. He's always challenging us. Jesus is a challenge in his person and in his character. Paul says in this letter that he is the image of the invisible God. How does invisibility have an image? Well, Paul answers that question with two words, Jesus Christ. He is the image of the invisible God. Now, the word used there for image is not copy. It means an exact manifestation and representation, the actual presence of God. That's what Paul says about Jesus, that he is the actual presence of God here on earth. Everything we know about God, we know because of Jesus. He is the bedrock of our faith. And Paul and John says in John chapter 1 and verse 18, we beheld his glory. And the word glory there means outshining, weight, worth. And John says, we walked with Jesus and we saw his glory. We saw his character coming out, his person, who he really was. And later on, when Jesus is talking to the disciples in John 14, he says, Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He is the image, the exact manifestation and representation of God. And when you think about it, he's fully God and fully man. When God became man, he became what he'd never been before, but he never ceased to be what he always was, God. Jesus was never more than man, but he was never less than God. Jesus is not man deified, and he's not God humanized. He's the true God-man. He never ceased to be God, and he was never more than man at any time in his experience. It's a mystery, it's a challenge, and it tells us something of the character of God. And when we consider the character of God in Jesus, there are two things that we can take to heart in. First of all, as the Son of God, he undertakes for me and for you. He says, my grace is sufficient for you in 2 Corinthians, isn't it? He says, my grace is sufficient for you. And my grace is sufficient for you in salvation. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. So when we put our trust in Christ as Saviour, we're saved on the basis of grace, his grace, not our works, however good they may be. His grace is sufficient for us in bereavement. Maybe some of you have been bereaved recently or know the pain of bereavement. Just over 2 years ago, I joined the Brotherhood of the Bereaved. I joined the community of the brokenhearted, but not downhearted, because beyond the earthly hearse is our heavenly hope of glory. He says, my grace is sufficient for you in your bereavement. Maybe like one of my sons, you've been made redundant because of COVID or the pandemic. He says, my grace is sufficient. Maybe you're struggling with health issues because of lockdown. Maybe you're mental health has been challenged because of lockdown. Maybe you feel lonely and anxious, even depressed and disillusioned and afraid. He says, my grace is sufficient. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. My grace is sufficient. Maybe growing older is part of the problem. I know the problem myself. I don't resent growing older because I've got members of my family and friends who've never had the privilege of growing older. And I know that growing older can be a challenge. When I get out of bed in the morning, if it doesn't ache, then it doesn't work. Only if it aches does it work. That's all part of the privilege of growing older. If it is a well, it is a privilege, isn't it? It's got to be a privilege because the alternative is unthinkable at times. God says to each of us, my grace is sufficient. No matter how old you are, you still have the value in service for God. So ask God what he wants you to do with what you have in terms of your experience of life and your gifting. He undertakes for us as the Son of God. And he understands us, says Jesus, as the Son of Man. The writer to the Hebrews in chapter 4 and verse 15 says, we have one, he's talking about our heavenly high priest, we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin. And it says, with loud cries and prayers that Jesus called out to God. He understands. Have you been deserted by friends or let down by friends and disappointed by friends? Jesus understands because he was. Have you been misunderstood and misquoted? Well, Jesus understands because that's what happened to him. Have you got prayer, a desperate prayer or maybe an urgent prayer that's gone unanswered? Well, Jesus understands. He prayed, my God, why have you forsaken me? And there was no answer. Heaven was silent. So he understands when you and I ask why. He suffered injustice. So if you've been a victim of injustice, then he understands. And if you've wept over the loss of a valued, loved friend, then he understands. He cried. Jesus wept at the tomb of Lazarus. So he understands all these things. He's the Son of God. Who undertakes, and he's the Son of Man who understands you and me. If you feel alone at this time, he says, I'm with you always. If you have a sense of weakness, he says, I will strengthen you. If you have a sense of anxiety, he leads us beside quiet waters. He restores our soul. And again, if you have tears, there's a day coming when he will wipe away all tears from our eyes. We're heading for a place where there are no tears. And you'll never be able to buy a box of Kleenex there because he will wipe away all tears. Some of you know that I have a visit Lebanon frequently, not recently anyway. And on one occasion when I was in Lebanon, a friend of mine took me to the caves of Jita, and we were driving through the countryside to the caves of Jita. We were driving down a long valley with the Litani River, the Lebanese river, flowing through it. And I was oohing and aahing at the splendor and the magnificence that was all around me. And my friend Raja said to me, Doug, he said, what's up ahead is even more glorious than this. And he was right. When I got to the caves of Jita, it's an amazing place deep inside the mountain. And there are stalagmites and stalactites and a crystal clear blue water on which you can sail on a boat. And it's an amazing place. And I was gasping at the glory of it all and the wonder of it all. What's up ahead, Doug, is greater than what you're seeing now, he said to me. Well, in a sense, that's true, isn't it? Jesus is supreme. We have a supreme Christ, says Paul. Supreme in the church, supreme in creation, supreme in his character. And he wants to be supreme in your life and mine because Up ahead, sisters and brothers, there is something more glorious than we have right now. May God bless you and encourage you in the days to come. We're going to sing a hymn now, and I'm sure you'll enjoy this hymn, and I'm sure you know it. In Christ alone, my hope is found. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us each and every one, now and until Jesus comes or calls, and then forever with the Lord. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name.
Lord, I lift your name on high.